This episode of Real Engineering is brought to you by Skillshare, home to 15,000 classes that could teach you a new life skill. The first 500 people to sign up with the link in the description will get a 2-month free trial. In August 2017, the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, in its most provocative move to date, tested a long-range intercontinental ballistic missile, which flew directly over the Japanese northern island of Hokkaido and set sirens wailing. This is just the latest in North Korean missile tests, with the previous month's test proving the North Korean dictatorship had the capability of reaching American soil. The engineers of North Korea have overcome many obstacles to get to this point, but just achieving the necessary range is thankfully half the battle. Today we're going to investigate the history behind these long-range weapons and why they are so difficult to engineer. An intercontinental ballistic missile, or ICBM, is a missile that follows a ballistic trajectory. Quite simply, the path it follows is the same as that of a thrown or propelled projectile would take under the act of gravity. Think of it as a projectile that is thrown extraordinarily fast and high by a relatively brief yet powerful rocket engine. Like many weapons of mass destruction, the Nazis were some of the first to theorize an ICBM. Project America, led by Wernher von Braun, was the codename for a weapon being developed that could be used against New York and other American cities during World War II. Just as the V-2, which was the world's first long-range ballistic missile, had been used to wreak havoc on London. Luckily, the war ended before it was fully developed, but many of these same engineers were drafted by the US and USSR after World War II to help design their first rockets, and many of these design philosophies laid the groundwork for what we see today. These early ICBM designs were essentially upgraded versions of the V-2 bombs. The V-2 was redesigned to include wings and dubbed the A-9. This would sit on top of the huge first stage dubbed the A-10, which would boost the V-2 from its original range of 300 kilometers, which was enough to reach London from the Netherlands, to 5,000 kilometers, enough to reach the American eastern seaboard from Ireland. The German engineers aimed the V-2 simply by setting a compass heading before launch, which allowed the internal guidance system, consisting of gyroscopes, to keep the rocket on course while the rockets were firing. Gyroscopes allow a missile to measure its deviation from initial flight trajectories. Spinning masses, like a gyroscope, want to maintain the direction their axis of rotation is pointing. So if we set the axis of rotation in the direction of desired travel, and mount the gyroscope in a frame that does not transfer the missile's rotation to the gyro, the missile can measure that change in rotation and correct its flight with control fins. The Germans controlled the range by simply adjusting the amount of fuel in the rocket, using a slide rule to calculate the fuel needed for a given trajectory. Although this was incredibly advanced technology for the time, the V-2s were still notoriously inaccurate because it relied completely on initial calculations on the ground and had no way of correcting for unexpected deviations. But London was a big target and the Netherlands weren't that far away, and the Germans certainly did not care who the bombs killed. To be effective against a target much further away though, would require a finer tuned guidance system, which the Germans did not have. So incredibly, these early ICBM designs were planned to be manned. After blasting off from Europe, exiting Earth's atmosphere, separating the first stage, reaching a max speed 10 times greater than the speed of sound, the second stage would come hurtling back through the atmosphere, where it would glide to its final target. If they hadn't already died from the heat of re-entry, the pilot would then set their final trajectory, using radio guidance from surface German submarines, and eject, only to be promptly killed by the force of impact of air hitting their head and chest. This was the Germans' kamikaze strategy. In an era before onboard computers and GPS existed, developing a guidance system was half the battle. Modern rockets use a combination of that gyroscope-based inertial guidance, satellite positioning, and terrain mapping, which uses altitude maps of the route to the target to guide the missile. You may wonder why the Germans put so much effort into creating space-age weapons, only to equip them with bombs less powerful than those they could drop from planes. Well, this is arguably the hardest part of the equation. The longer the range, and the heavier the load, the more complex the rocket. Just adding a first stage adds a significant amount of complexity and cost to the design. Adding a massive bomb was simply not feasible, and that's just an issue of size and weight. The Germans were limited to the type of bomb they could use for another reason. This is a size comparison between the V-2 rockets and the two nuclear bombs dropped on Japan. Size-wise, it's not that inconceivable that these bombs could have been integrated into the V-2, but the fat man and little boy weighed 4.6 and 4.4 tons respectively, so the weight would have been a huge issue. The V-2's warhead consisted of a 1-ton Amatol bomb, which is a TNT-based explosive. TNT's primary advantage is its high activation energy, meaning it would not easily detonate from a sudden impact shock or from heat. Even if small, lightweight nuclear bombs existed at the time, neither America or Germany had the technology required to launch them with a missile because of the intense heat associated with re-entry of ICBMs would destroy the warhead before it ever got close to the target. Re-entry vehicles typically use a combination of blunt body design, ablative materials, heat sinks and insulating materials. Blunt body design allows the re-entry vehicle to create a bow shock wave in front of the vehicle that keeps the superheated plasma a little further away from the vehicle's surface, with an insulating boundary layer of air in between. Ablative materials, like the single-use Gemini heat shield, burn or melt and they detach from the vehicle, carrying some of that superheated plasma away, and heat sinks use conductive and heat-resistant materials, like beryllium, to spread some of that heat and allow it to be radiated away. The Discovery Space Shuttle used reusable and replaceable thermal tiles and blankets, while the nose cone was a carbon-carbon composite, which acted as a heat sink. But all of these things have one thing in common: they add bulk and mass to the design once again. Simply put, designing a rocket capable of launching out of Earth's atmosphere is arguably the easiest and most well-documented part of building an ICBM. Miniaturizing nuclear bombs capable of withstanding the journey and creating a guidance system accurate enough to hit the target is a whole other challenge. We know North Korea is struggling with this part of their missile program, as the re-entry of their July launch was caught on CCTV, showing the missile burning up and disintegrating before landing in the sea off the coast of Japan, and their recent test had a similar fate. So even if North Korea have a miniaturized nuclear bomb, it's unlikely it would survive the journey. And when it comes to guidance, North Korea do not have their own positioning satellites, and it's unlikely that China have granted them access to their high-accuracy military positioning system. For now, North Korea don't pose much of a threat to America, but if they did somehow develop an ICBM capable of carrying nuclear weapons, despite the heavy embargoes on the country, the world has moved on since the days of the V2 bombardment of defenseless London. There are countermeasures, and we'll explore them in the next video. But if you want to watch something right now and learn something new, I suggest you check out Skillshare.com, where you can find thousands of different classes in a whole range of subjects. Name a creative skill, and they probably have a class to teach you how to use it. I have been trying to up my photography game lately, and have been finding their photography classes incredibly useful. These days you can teach yourself pretty much any skill online, and Skillshare is a fantastic place to do it. With professional and understandable classes that follow a clear learning curve, you could even learn the skills to start a new business, like I did with this channel, through courses for animation and editing. A premium membership begins around $10 a month for unlimited access to all courses, but the first 500 people to sign up with this link will get a 2-month free trial. In those 2 months, you could easily learn the skills you need to start a new hobby or business, just like I did with this channel. So ask yourself right now, what skills have you been putting off learning? What project have you been dreaming of completing, but you aren't sure if you have the skills to do it? Why not start right now and sign up to Skillshare using the link below? You've nothing to lose and a valuable life skill to gain. As usual, thanks for watching, and thank you to all my Patreon supporters for helping this channel exist. If you'd like to see more from me, the links to my social media accounts are in the description, and don't forget to check out the latest episode of my podcast with Sam from Wendover Productions.